Now, we're on to the 8th meeting in 2024 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. We will consider the Budget Bill at Stage 2 today, but before we turn to formal Stage 2 proceedings, we will take evidence on the Scottish Government's response to a report on the Scottish Budget 2024-25. We are joined today by Shona Robison, Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for Finance. The Cabinet Secretary is accompanied by Scottish Government officials, Dr Alison Cumming, Director of Budget and Public Spending, Ian Storey, Head of Local Government Finance, and Lorraine King, Deputy Director, Tax and Revenues Directorate. I welcome our witness to the meeting. Members received copies of the Scottish Government response on Friday. But before we move to questions from the committee, I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a short opening statement. Cabinet Secretary.
Well, good morning. Thanks, Convener. I'd like to thank the committee for its budget scrutiny report, which I have carefully considered. As I have highlighted to the committee and to Parliament, this budget has been developed amidst very challenging economic and fiscal circumstances. The UK Government's autumn statement was a worst-case scenario for Scotland, and we have further significant uncertainty on the horizon with the spring statement on the 6th of March. And while there appears to be a briefing to some newspapers relating to tax, we are clear that the UK Government needs to use any headroom it has to invest in services and provide consequentials for the costs of the 23-24 NHS Agenda for Change pay agreements in the coming financial year, something that was totally absent in the autumn statement. Subject to what spring budget delivers, as I've already advised local government, I am committed to passing on in full any consequentials received in response to increased teacher pension contributions and the estimated £45 million of additional funding to local government following the UK Government announcement in January, should they be confirmed as net additions to the Scottish Budget. I think it's a fair budget for local government, but I don't underestimate that it's a challenging one, and it's challenging right across the public sector. Also, if the capital funding position improves, I will also consider the funding position for our affordable housing supply programme. That continues to be a key priority for me. All of this depends on the availability of additional funding from the UK Government, and this continues to be an uncertain position. While additional funding is always welcome, the funding position could worsen, also negatively affecting the assumptions underpinning the Scottish Budget to date. And as we've just seen again, the UK Government can unexpectedly reduce our funding, and this is an ongoing risk. The recent UK supplementary estimates now indicate a reduction in our financial transactions this year of £64 million. This is unexpected and will be hard to manage, with it potentially impacting on key policy areas such as housing. That's why it's so important for the UK Government to use the spring budget as an opportunity to improve the capital budget position, which will be crucial for affordable housing plans and indeed other priorities such as NHS infrastructure projects. While I'm not proposing amendments to the budget bill today, the committee will be aware of the cabinet changes announced by the First Minister on the 8th of February. Combining the economy, net zero and energy into a new portfolio creates a strong portfolio for building Scotland's economy. These changes also now require transport as an individual portfolio, reflecting the importance and complexity of this vital delivery area. These portfolio changes do affect the Scottish Budget, which is why I'll be proposing to introduce a small number of technical amendments at Stage 3 to reflect these portfolio changes. The committee will appreciate that there was insufficient time to prepare these amendments ahead of Stage 2 lodging deadline of the 9th of February. So I thank committee members for their ongoing engagement on the Budget Bill and look forward to our discussions this morning.
Okay, thank you very much for that helpful opening statement. I mean, it seems to me, given the continued reference both this morning and indeed in the report to the spring statement on the 6th of March, would it not be more helpful I realise the timescales that you're operating to with the budget bill, would it not be more helpful if our budget would have been after the 6th of March? That would have given the Scottish Government a greater opportunity to reflect on what the UK is doing. Of course, obviously, given the fact that we already had scheduled our budget, it would have been more helpful if the UK Government had their spring budget before our Stage 3.
Well, indeed. I mean, the difficulty is of the constrained timetable that we operate in, not least in terms of making sure the our tax position is clear and that's notified and so on and so forth, and that the public sector is aware of the budget position well in advance of the start of the financial year. The spring budget timetable is very, very challenging indeed. We've made that point to the Chief Secretary of the Treasury. We've also made the point that it could severely impact, barely a week later, on our assumptions in the budget. We've made some very direct requests around the basis of our budget. At the moment, of course, is set on the autumn statement. We've asked for flexibility on that, should the spring statement offer opportunities for us to enhance the budget, then we would want that flexibility. There is precedence for that previously in previous years where that flexibility was given. And I think in the light of these circumstances, that would be helpful. At the moment, we've had no confirmation from Treasury that that flexibility will be given.
Okay, thank you for that. Now, obviously, the main reason for this session this morning, prior to stage two, is to go through the report that we had and the responses to. I'm not going to go through all of it because I've got six colleagues who want to come in and set in areas, but I'll touch on a number of areas and others may wish to build on those. So the first one I want to talk about is really the in terms of recommendation 41, the potential impact on business and the economy of the differential income tax policies in Scotland and the rest of the UK. In your response, you've said that the move to a five-band system alongside additional government spending as a result of the policy change had a relatively negligible impact on the size and growth rate of the Scottish economy in the short term. So I'm just wondering what long-term work is being done to see whether or not that has longer-term impacts, either positive or negative.
So it's important that we do take that, both that short-term and longer-term view. Clearly, the modelling done by the Scottish Fiscal Commission takes into account things like behaviour change, but we have the piece of work undertaken by HMRC that will be published later this year that is going to provide more detail. And, of course, that's something that we want to continue to look at and monitor and evaluate in terms of any impact, whether that's on behaviour change or any other element of the economy. So we will do that through the auspices of organisations that I think are are trusted, are independent, HMRC, the work that they're doing will be extremely valuable in this space. So as soon as we have that information and that information is in the public domain, I'm sure the committee will want to take an interest in that.
Now, one of the issues we raised at 46 was the little evidence of either government seeking to avoid or resolve the anomalies rising from the way tax and national insurance policies align, and you've responded they accept the high marginal rate of tax for both income tax and national insurance faced by some taxpayers between Scottish and UK higher thresholds results from incomplete devolution of tax powers. But Fraser Valander have said that the Scottish Government, to address this issue, there would have to be significant increases to basic and intermediate rates. Now, you've said that the UK has refused to substantively engage on this matter, and you continue to call on the UK Government with regard to interactions and engagement with devolved policy when setting national insurance contributions policy. Now, they would argue that it's because the Scottish Government has got a different the Scottish Government has chosen to actually set a different higher rate of tax than the UK. So, you know, one could argue that it's the Scottish Government that should change. So is the Scottish Government going to, given the fact that the UK Government is unlikely to change its position, is it going to, what will it do to try and minimise these marginal rates whereby people are effectively paying a 52% marginal rate on £43,666 a year?
So I would go back to the point that these marginal rate thresholds do, I think, fundamentally arise because of the incomplete devolution of tax powers. So we've got two systems that are working, and the powers, obviously, of the Scottish Parliament, of the Scottish Government, to be able to vary tax powers have been set for quite some time, and the interaction with the UK government in terms of their tax position, I don't think has properly been resolved. I think there is a need to do so, but that has to be a two-way street, and you know, we are up for that discussion to look at how we can take these matters forward. But we have really not been able to engage in a way that is helpful or constructive. The Fraser of Allender, you've noted around the significant increase to the basic and intermediate rates. I mean, given, I don't think that would be appropriate given the pressure on household budgets. And I think the solution to that would be a tax system that is fully devolved to Scotland, so that we can drive out these anomalies that arise. The marginal rates are a concern. It's something that we will continue to pay attention to, and we'll look potentially to resolve if we can over the longer term, but the funding to be able to do so and the implications within these constrained financial times would be very, very difficult. We recognise it's far from ideal, but resolving it in the short term would just not be affordable.
Okay, and on the issue of not being affordable, you can use that argument in terms of not passing on the non-domestic rates consequentials, where you've said that money is because of the very worst-case scenario, UK government open statement, you've said that money's had to go into public services, for example, the NHS, although you have gone on to say that the basic property rate for non-domestic properties with a rateable value up to and including £51,000 will be frozen, delivering the lowest such rate in the UK for the 6 year in a row. And you also talked about how for islands and some three very remote communities, the rates have been capped at £110,000 per ratepayer with 100% rates relief. But I'm just wondering, have you had any discussions with the UK government regarding the VAT threshold? And the VAT threshold has been stuck at £85,000 a year since 2017. Cumulative inflation since then has been 32%. And the Federation of Small Businesses has said that a significant number, more than a third of their members, are reluctant to kind of grow their business because it takes them into that VAT threshold. And of course, if the VAT threshold was increased, it would allow local businesses to have more money in their pockets as opposed to having to pay 20% over and above that threshold. So I'm just wondering if that's a way in which the Scottish Government is engaging with the UK in order to try and help small businesses, while at the same time, you know, not having to reduce non-domestic rates income at a time when the Scottish Government is already paying £685 million a year in release from next April and has to use the money in other areas of its budget.
So it is an issue that we have raised, and in fact, I had, alongside other ministers, a very constructive meeting with the hospitality sector. Don't get me wrong, of course they would have liked NDR relief to have been passed on in Scotland, of course, but I wanted to be really clear with them that we had a difficult choice to make of either investing that money in public services or investing it in business rates tax cut. And if you think of the £310 million of consequentials, £260 million of that was for business tax cuts. And I'm afraid, in the light of the pressures on public services, I couldn't in all conscience do that. Once we then talked about other areas, and actually one of the key issues they raised was the concerns about VAT. And in fact, I've since seen some interviews with leaders of the hospitality sector within England who are calling for changes to the VAT threshold because of the impact that is making on their businesses. So it is I guess, a complex landscape with a number of pressures, the price and cost of goods, of power, in terms of premises, all of these things all impact. I think you're also right to point to the package of reliefs is significant, worth an estimated £685 million for 24-25. That includes the small business bonus scheme. So we have a very competitive support package for businesses, and of course we've gone further in the support, the 100% relief for the islands and indeed remote areas of Scotland that are essentially hard to access, and we've given relief to those areas as well. And what we intend to do is to monitor the impact of that, to I guess try to develop a bit of an evidence base of whether or not the reliefs are working in the way that were intended. I suspect the reliefs are not going to, I might be wrong on this, but my suspicion is that they probably will not continue in England beyond this year. And what we are keen to do is, rather than have stop and start reliefs for the sector, we've committed and are working with the sector to look at what we can do in the long term that gives that long-term sustainable support to the sector, rather than it potentially falling off a cliff edge at some point in the near future, which I don't think is helpful.
I mean, that leads me on to something I wasn't going to ask about, because other colleagues will probably want to come in on it, but you've talked about whether or not that will be retained in England. Well, a lot of people have asked about the council tax freeze, whether that's going to be baselined into the local government settlements. I just wonder if you can tell us just now whether that is going to be the case.
Yeah, I've confirmed to local government it will be baselined into the settlements. I confirmed that in a letter to them couple of weeks ago, yeah.
And local authorities who actually do accept the 5% council tax freeze, will they benefit from having money redistributed from local authorities that don't accept it? So, for example, say half the councils accept it and half don't. Will those who don't accept the council tax freeze, will that money, which would be £70 million if half of them didn't accept it, just as an example, would that be given to the local authorities that have accepted the freeze?
Haven't made any decisions about, I mean, I'm being optimistic that all of that funding will be utilised for the purpose it's intended for. Should there be any funding remaining, we haven't made any decisions about how that money will be distributed.
Okay, thank you for that. Now, in paragraph 95, we raised the concerns about the affordability and sustainability of the social security budget, which is growing inexorably, and I'm not making any comment whether that's a good or a bad thing, but just in terms of the finances. But one thing did leap out at me in terms of your response. You said the Scottish Government will ensure that there's budget cover within the overall Scottish budget envelope to cover Social Security. Now, is that therefore the Government saying that the Social Security budget is sacrosanct, and that regardless of how demand grows or indeed reduces, the Scottish Government will meet that?
I'm not sure I put it in those terms. I think what I would say is that it is a key priority, an investment for us. It has clearly been an area of growth as we introduce new benefits and we make changes to existing benefits. And that has led, as you're well aware, to significant expenditure and commitment beyond the block grant adjustment from the UK government. What I would say is that work is being undertaken that is important actually around that longer term sustainability to make sure that that the social security funding going forward is able to continue to deliver what it needs to deliver. So that will mean making sure that there's efficiency, that it's effective, that the decision-making processes are as good and effective as they can be, and that there's fairness there in making sure that particularly the new benefits that are being delivered in a way that is fair to everybody. So that means we do need to scrutinise the operation of how Social Security is delivered and make sure that, I guess, going back to that efficiency and effectiveness, is there within that system. So is it an open checkbook? No, if that's what you're asking me. It's a priority, but within that, clearly, we need to make sure it's sustainable in the long term. So there is a lot of work being undertaken in that respect, because we do recognise, and the challenge that you'll make to me is, and external organisations will make, is if you look at that growth going forward, then it is a key pressure on the Scottish Government, the Scottish budget, and we need to be aware of that.
Okay, thank you for that. This is an area I think more colleagues will want to come in on, but I'm just going to touch on one aspect of it, and it's paragraph 102, which is regarding how the Scottish Government has its intended prioritise its spending towards supporting the delivery of a fair, green and growing economy. And, it struck me at the bottom of page 9 of your response, what you've said is, and I quote, the Scottish budget also commits to exploring future multi-annual funding for employability services in recognition of the benefits of greater certainty for those planning services and the people accessing support. Now, we've called for multi-year funding settlements. I'm well aware that the UK Government doesn't give multi-year settlements. In fact, you know, we had a kind of autumn statement in November, and now we're going to have a spring statement in March. So I realise there is it's not easy to pin these things down, but it just seems to me that this almost jumps out as if this is the one area of the Scottish budget where you're looking at long-term funding. So why not in other areas? So what other areas, for example, because local government has been calling for long-term and multi-year funding, which is more efficient, allows them to plan better, etc., etc.
So I think if you recognise that employability is quite often delivered by third sector organisations, I've got a lot of sympathy for the third sector more broadly and their call for multi-year funding. I think there's a trade-off if they're, and actually my discussions with third sector organisations, often they will say that they're more concerned about the multi-year funding than they are about the quantum, that they knowing how much they'll have and being able to retain staff, for example, is really important. I get that, and I'm really sympathetic to that. So we have tried to move with third sector organisations to look at whether or not we can, at the very least, when finances are tight, give that certainty over more than 1 year. Being able to do that for large areas of spend, like local government, would be very challenging in the light of us only having year-to-year budgets at the moment. So what I wouldn't want to do is to give a kind of false premise for, you know, it's a third, almost a third of the budget. You know, and if we assumed and made assumptions that were then just not correct because we're basing it on speculation when we don't know, because we've only got that 1 year horizon ourselves, and the fiscal uncertainty at the moment is huge, then I don't think that's going to be helpful to a huge area of spend like local government. But it's easier to do in smaller areas of spend where, you know, the margins of change can be managed more effectively. So for me, the third sector, I think, is a good area to try and give that certainty to, because, as I said earlier, they do struggle sometimes to hold on to staff because contracts are coming to an end and there's no certainty about funding, and I'm very sympathetic to that.
Yeah, I feel that would be very welcome. I think the sooner that would be introduced, the better it would be. Now, enterprise is obviously an issue, and if one reads the response without actually looking at the budget, one would think everything was kind of pretty hunky-dory in terms of the government prioritising enterprise. But it isn't. What's being said in the response, I don't think, is really reflected in the budget figures. So, for example, again, in response to that paragraph 102, you said, we have prioritised funding for the enterprise agencies to the extent possible, given the extremely challenging environment. And you said to the extent possible, but I look at a 15% reduction, which is pretty harsh, given even if we look at the overall settlement, the Scottish Government's budget hasn't been reduced by that. This committee is of the view that we need a kind of widening tax base, which you do refer to in other areas of your report, and indeed a growing tax base. And it just seems to myself and indeed colleagues that 15% seems a pretty severe cut at such a time.
So we've allocated over £307 million for the enterprise agencies in 24-25. We've been very clear that because of the challenging funding position, that we'll have to be really clear about what the priorities are, and we'll have to be clear that they will need to focus on the things that are absolutely critical. I guess it comes back...
That already? I mean, surely they do that already, you know, I mean...
We asked them to do a lot of various things. I was struck by some business leaders that I was speaking to were talking about, I think it was a six-page letter that had gone to one of our enterprise agencies asking them in terms of the things that Scottish Government asks them to do. I think we need to be more focused and sharper on what it is that the priorities are around particularly the next year and the immediate future. Look, I mean, to be blunt, I have had and I've tried, and I think you can see this through, if you look at the budget lines for frontline services, that the discussions we're having around health, police, fire are pretty limited, and that's probably because I've focused and prioritised frontline public services in terms of where the money is going. That has meant really difficult decisions elsewhere in making the budget stack up. Is it what I would want to have done in an ideal world? No, but when money is tight, we had to prioritise frontline public spending, and that has meant we've had to constrain funding elsewhere, and it means our enterprise agencies will have to utilise that £307 million in a very careful and targeted way in terms of aligning to the priorities. There are other elements in the budget where we've committed funding to our priorities, offshore wind, etc., where we have made some additional investments. But it is a tough budget for our enterprise agencies. There's no getting away from that. And we have to be clear on what we're asking them to do with that money.
OK, I'm going to let colleagues in soon, so I'm not going to ask much more and wade through the whole report. But you did say in response to paragraph 112 that we've prioritised funding for the Scottish National Investment Bank, but I don't see how that statement can possibly bear up to scrutiny when there's a 28% reduction in its funding. I mean, that can't be classed as prioritisation, surely, under any measure. And I would have thought that an organisation like that, which is required to lever in private funding, you kind of get more bang for your buck. I mean, I fully appreciate the need to spend money in public services, but if you're not generating additional wealth, you're not going to be able to do that for long. You're effectively meaning that next year we're going to be in the same position or worse. So how has the Scottish Government prioritised the Scottish National Investment Bank if the funding has fallen so dramatically?
We've essentially given them the vast bulk of the financial transactions that we have available to us. But if you remember, and we've had this discussion previously, that financial transactions have gone off a cliff as well in terms of UK government. And that's unfortunate because the two areas of spend for financial transactions traditionally have been the Affordable Housing Supply Programme and SNB. So we have prioritised SNB in getting the financial transactions that we have available to us. That has meant, of course, that the Affordable Housing Supply Programme has less financial transactions available to it. The supplementary estimates that I referred to earlier on, with a £64 million reduction in financial transactions that we will get the flexibility to manage in 24-25, is just going to heap pressure on those areas of government that use financial transactions. So we've now got that additional pressure into the pot of managing that further reduction in FTs that we will have to assess once we see the full picture in the spring budget on the 6th of March. So I just make the point that You know, FTs are a really, really useful source of funding, and we have traditionally utilised them very well in those two areas of spend. But when they are significantly reduced, it has an impact. And we're not able, because of the capital position, to supplement the reduction in FTs with traditional capital, because we've got a 10% reduction in capital availability as well. So these things are, have an impact, and that is the impact that they're having. If that position changes in the spring budget, then clearly it's something we would want to revisit, because we recognise the importance of SNB.
Yeah, I mean, you've talked also about capital and how important it would be the spring budget reverses some of the reductions in capital allocation. I think the issue about capital is, although many commentators, you know, managed to avoid mentioning the reduction in the Scottish Government's capital allocation, surprise, surprise, but it's I think it's the percentage of reduction in the housing budget that has raised so many eyebrows at a time when there's serious pressure in terms of housing demand in Scotland.
So the biggest reduction is on financial transactions. Mm-hmm. If you look at the capital reduction, it's about 13%. And I would want, as I said before, that's a priority to re-establish the capital element. It's difficult to do that for financial transactions, and more difficult now that we've got a further reduction in financial transactions to manage within 24-25. And it comes back to those areas that I know have been a priority for this committee, SNB, Affordable Housing Supply Programme. So reductions in FTs are absolutely the worst thing that could happen. So, you know, I will look very, very carefully at the position after the 6th of March to look at whether or not, whether it's through additional capital, and we've called for that. I mean, if you translate that percentage into cash, I mean, that's £1.6 billion less to spend by 2027-28. You know, about £540 million a year. That's a lot of investment in whether it's affordable housing, whether it's health infrastructure, whether it's anything else. That's a lot to absorb. So we need that position to be reversed. We'll also look to our own position of whether or not, once we get to the end of this financial year, what our position is, and whether or not there's and we'll look at our borrowing position as well. So we need to look at all of that in the round. And I would want to come back to Parliament in the light of all that and look at whether any of these positions can be changed in year.
Flexibility is therefore very important. And one of the things that my local authority has raised with me directly is inflexibility in terms of teacher numbers. And we know some of the politics behind that, but in North Ayrshire, they have got 1,000 fewer pupils than they had 4 years ago, and they've now got a teacher-pupil ratio of one teacher to 12 children. So they're saying it's, and I quote, madness to spend additional money on new teachers when they already have more than enough teachers, and they would rather spend the money on, for example, educational psychologists, support staff, etc., which they can't afford because they've been forced to spend the money on teachers. Now, I know this is an issue affecting other local authorities across Scotland, and so surely, even if the money is ring-fenced for education, local authorities should have the flexibility to decide how they're going to spend that money as appropriate locally.
So let me say a couple of things about that. Clearly, Parliament has taken a lot of interest in closing the poverty-related attainment gap, and I think our firm belief is that in order teachers play a crucial role in being able to do that. And of course, we are investing £1 billion in the Scottish Attainment Challenge over the course of this Parliament. So we recognise that teacher workforce is at the heart of that, but there are also other important supports that are provided through schools and other agencies. I think for me, the solution, because you make a point that, you know, the position of teacher numbers is not universal across Scotland. So what do we do about that? Well, the offer to COSLA has been the Education Assurance Board, where we would like to get to, I guess, what you could describe as a single point of truth of what does the workforce, the teaching workforce, look like and need to look like over the next few years to be able to get to the the numbers that are more accurately reflect the fact that there are differing positions. So some areas are growing, and I think overall, actually, the pupil role, you know, has increased by over 30,000 over the last decade. So it's not true to say that the overall position is down, but there is variation across the country. And I think that board, getting that board established and being able then to look at what the actual workforce numbers required going forward are would be, enable us to more closely align that going forward with what is required in order to maintain teacher numbers in the right numbers in the right areas. So, you know, that for us is the key missing bit, and that board needs to be established and that work taken forward.
Rather than a board, it might be easier just to let local authorities do what they think is best for their area with the resources that they have. But I'll move on.
And the Education Secretary would be going to Parliament asking questions, no doubt, about the number of teachers
involved. I'm well aware of that, but the government has to do the right thing, as opposed to, we all know that opposition politics will stand up and say there's X number of teachers fewer than there was a few years ago, but the way to defend it is clearly by improved outcomes, mm-hmm. Through having the right mix in schools of teachers and support staff, psychologists, everything else. Because if we're talking about attainment challenges, it's not just about teachers, okay. It's about the whole structure in a school. Mm-hmm. But I'll move on, because colleagues will want to come in. And it's just this one, which is basically that in paragraph 144, we requested an update when the Scottish Government will seek to schedule a parliamentary debate on financial long-term sustainability of Scotland's finances. And the report responds that the Scottish Government continues to support a debate on the long-term sustainability of Scotland's finances, confirmed by the Deputy First Minister on 3rd of October. But that's 5 months ago. We still haven't got a scheduled date. And let's be honest, some of the debates we've had in the Chamber haven't exactly, been thrillers. I mean, we've actually had... all I'll say is that many times we've been in the Chamber and the presiding officer has said... I will allow the member a very generous 6 minutes, because there's no great enthusiasm. Debates which could last an hour are being extended to two hours, 20 minutes or whatever, whereas things like this, which are actually important, are not being scheduled.
Well, I'm happy to schedule that. My suggestion is that we do it alongside... Well, first of all, we need to see the spring budget is, but that we do it alongside the medium-term financial strategy, which does take that longer-term outlook. But I agree with you that we need to even go beyond that in looking at some of the pressures. We've mentioned Social Security as one. So I'm happy to do that. I've got no issues. It just needs to be, scheduled in a way that is going to be helpful and that is going to look beyond, the day-to-day debates that we have with each other in the Parliament about spend on this area or spend on that area. I would welcome, actually, being able to look beyond some of those day-to-day debates that we have. So I'm happy to commit to the time, but let's make sure we're in full command of all of the information we need in front of us, which we need to get beyond spring budget. And I would, so the offer is in and around MTFS time, if that's helpful, Convener.
Thank you very much. And lots more to cover, but we have a full house, so I'm going to open up to colleagues. The first will be Liz, to be followed by Ross.
Thank you. Cabinet Secretary, I wonder if I can ask firstly about your response to paragraph 40 when you said, in relation to looking at the impact of tax policy changes on the wider economy, that you've been using, and I quote, a range of evidence, including real-time economic data, obviously, formal evaluations, and you gave one example of that as the income tax evaluation from 2018-19 reforms. Can I ask you about the statistics that you received in that evaluation, what the other formal evaluations are about behavioural change and the impact of tax policy change?
Yeah, so we look, of course, first of all, to make sure that the SFC, when they are giving us the advice and doing the analysis, is that of course, that's built in to their assumptions in terms of any impact that our tax decisions may or may not have. And they've judged, I think they describe it as not economy moving over their five-year forecast horizon. I mentioned earlier on HMRC, who are developing, helping us develop the evidence base on priority areas of research interest, such as behaviour change, which includes things like cross-border mobility. And we'll publish further information on this later in the year. And I think that's going to be important because they are able to drill down more because of the information that they have available to them. And you know, we will, if there are other areas of evaluation that come from other organisations, then we always look at those as well in terms of independent analysis and independent bodies that will make comment on this area. So we draw from a range of sources. SFC, though, is fundamental because they're able to analyse, you know, what we are intending to do and put it through that system of analysis of whether, in their view, it would have an impact on things like behavioural change, for example.
Thank you for that, Cabinet Secretary. It is, of course, the decision of ministers as to what changes to make to tax policy. And you're very clear in the next paragraph that, you know, you're saying that there was a relatively negligible impact on the size and growth rate of the economy for the short term by moving to the five-band system. Can I specifically ask about what long-term analysis the Scottish Government has done on the basis of the information that you've been provided by the SFC and other financial information?
Well, that is why the HMRC data is important, that we look at the... Well, in some ways, the behavioural change will, I guess, be... we'll need to track whether or not there's behavioural change from year to year, because you can't foresee into 5-10 years' time what a policy intervention in terms of tax will have, because the data will only really emerge in terms of behavioural change, if that's what we're talking about, as and when it emerges, which is why the HMRC data is important. Other data will be things like the National Records of Scotland in terms of migration. So at the moment we have a positive in-migration of around 7,000 a year working age population. We're going to be keeping a very close eye on that in terms of whether or not there's a shift. So the data is data that inevitably is not forward-looking, because data by its nature is looking back on what has happened. But we will continue to look at trends, and I think it's the trends that will be important here. And if there's a change in trend that indicates that there is a different direction of travel, then clearly that is something that we would want to look at very carefully.
Well, I think many people would want to see that the evidence provided is the basis for the decision-making. And if that evidence is not being compiled until after the decisions, it puts the Scottish Government in quite a difficult situation, because I think many people feel, well, you've seen the reactions from the business community particularly, that, you know, they feel that the evidence about the changes that have been made is actually not being compiled. And there's a great worry that some of the behavioural changes that will happen could be very detrimental to the economy. And as I say, you've seen...
But that is being compiled. It's been being compiled. Well, the SFC obviously will do an analysis on looking at what they believe the impact to be, but then we will track that through real-term data and real-time data through HMRC and look at the trends to see whether in actual fact there is any impact. So I guess that's the point I'm trying to make, that HMRC within all this is really important, because they have the actual data of whether or not there's behavioural change, and they'll be able to disaggregate that in terms of the various bands of taxpayers.
Yeah, Cabinet Secretary, I don't doubt that. It's just the fact that that is not going to be compiled until after the decisions have been made. That's the issue. But can I just come to the other part of your sentence where you say that the engagement with stakeholders, including some of those in the business community, have been very important. Can I just ask you who it was in the business community who was supportive of your income tax changes?
Well, we meet business leaders representatives of the business community on a regular basis, and you know, we talk about not just our own income tax policy, but a range of policies in relation to the impact on them, including, of course, areas of tax policy relating to UK government policy, and they will express a range of views. So, do businesses want to pay more tax? Probably not in the main, I would suggest. But of course, that's the position with VAT as well. Businesses are saying they want changes to the VAT regime for the same reason. And I guess our levers at our disposal, so take NDR, we had a very difficult decision to make around, do you put that resource into business tax cuts that the retail, hospitality and leisure sector, of course, would have wanted us to make that choice. But I think they also understand, and certainly the hospitality sector that I met with understood that we had made a decision to invest that in public services. You can't invest it twice. So they might not have agreed with it, but I think they understood why we had made that decision.
Well, I'll come to retail in just a minute, but were there people in the business community who were supportive of the Scottish Government's tax changes?
Well, I think the business community will they will give their view as a business community. As individuals, I'm sure there are business leaders who believe in progressive taxation. I've no doubt about that at all. But the business community will represent themselves in terms of they want lower taxes for their businesses. I have no doubt about that. And they will make those representations, whether it's about business taxes, whether it's about VAT. But as a government, we have a judgment to make about how we fund public services. If we're going to reduce taxes for business or indeed income tax, then that means less money for public services. And those are the balances that governments have to make and the decisions that we have to make. And we've made a decision to invest in public services through the tax decisions we've made, whether it's income tax or business taxes.
Well, I have to say, I think the business community almost universally has not been supportive of the changes, because
they are users of public services as well, of course, and I think they recognise that the importance of investing in public services.
Of course they are, but they're also the ones that can stimulate economic growth. Can I just come to the paper that we received from the Scottish Retail Consortium? And I quote, "We are absolutely flummoxed as to why retail in general and one subsector of retail in particular has been singled out as for the potential business rate surtax. They see this as unfair and inequitable." Could you comment on that?
Well, I've been very clear with the retail, hospitality and leisure sector when I've met with organisations or indeed individual businesses that the choice of what I did with the 260 million out of the 310 million consequentials was a choice of either to invest that into public services or to invest it in business tax cuts. And I couldn't in all conscience not invest that in public services, primarily the NHS. Now, you know, you'll be aware, Liz Smith, that day in, day out, we hear from your own backbenchers calls for additional public spending in many areas, including the NHS. So I suspect that had I given that 260 million to business tax cuts for retail, hospitality and leisure, that I would have been answering questions either here or in Parliament about why there was less money for frontline public services. So ultimately, these are decisions that have to be made, but in a constrained fiscal environment where money is tight, I couldn't in all conscience not give that money to the NHS, but rather give it in business taxes. It's for others to say if that they would have made different choices, what the impact would have been on public services through those different choices.
Sorry, can I just bring you back to the business rate surtax proposals, which is what I'm asking about, because we've got a very detailed paper from the Scottish Retail Consortium setting out, I think it's somewhere in the region of about seven or eight very serious objections to the possible introduction of this, because they feel Well, there are two things. One, they make a bitter complaint that when it came to the discussion about the New Deal for business, that the Scottish Government said that there would be no surprises, and I quote, this came as a complete surprise to them, so I think that's an announcement without a warning. But also, in terms of the behavioural change, they've set out really pretty substantial concerns, and I just wondered on what basis you had modelled the potential impact of the surtax.
So, forgive me, I hadn't realised you were talking about public health supplement, but let me address that very directly. So we have the commitment is to explore and look at the potential of introducing a public health supplement, something that was obviously done previously. And as part of that process, we have had some very early engagement with the very business organisations that you're talking about, and we've said to them very directly that we want to look at any evidence of impact that they can provide, and we're engaging with them. I've met them directly, as have other ministers, and we'll continue to have that dialogue with them. Clearly there will be other organisations, not least public health organisations, that will have a different view, and we will look at all of that in the round before making any decisions in terms of the 25-26 budget position. So that early engagement actually was one of the commitments that was made in terms of the New Deal, and that early engagement is now underway.
Okay, just my last point, Cabinet Secretary, on that. The Scottish Retail Consortium is making the point that the budget document states that it's about that tax, should it come in, is about plugging the shortfall in devolved finances, but yet the Scottish Government's putting it across as a tax that would be hypothecated for public health. And in fact, you've just mentioned the title of that just now. It's a public health supplement, I think you said. Can we just get it clear? Is the intention to bring in that tax on a public health agenda, or is it simply to try to plug the big black hole in the Scottish Government's finances?
Well, of course, any gap in the public finances are due in part and in large part to decisions made by the UK Government in terms of our financial position. So that, and that can be addressed on the 6th of March, the spring budget, if the UK Government so wishes. I think it's important, and it would have a focus on public health, and looking at specifically how we can raise additional revenues to support some of the public health challenges. But I stress that no decisions have been made to definitely take that measure forward. What we're doing is consulting at an early stage around the evidence, what it tells us, and asking the business community itself to provide some of that, and that engagement will continue.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, Ross, to follow by Michelle.
Thanks, Convener. Just following on Liz Smith's line of question, Cabinet Secretary, around the public health levy, the Retail Consortium made the point that from their perspective, it's targeting a particular sector of retail, and that particular sector is supermarkets who sell alcohol and tobacco. As you've explained, this is a public health levy. Alcohol and tobacco have significant public health impact. You may not have this to hand, but do you have even a rough ballpark idea? How much does the negative health effects of alcohol and tobacco cost our public services, cost the NHS every year?
I don't know if I have that figure to hand, but I do remember from my health days of it being very significant indeed. In fact, there was a couple of figures I had when I moved the minimum unit pricing regulations a couple of weeks ago about the impact. I just can't quite remember off the top of my head, but we can certainly get that for the committee if that's helpful. But it's very significant, and we know that Scotland's relationship with alcohol goes very deep and is very challenging. And it's not just the health impact, it's the economic impact, lost days at work and so on and so forth. So it is considerable.
And is it not the case that if without a public health supplement, so at the moment, the difference from the minimum unit price is essentially just pocketed directly by the retailer. There's not currently a mechanism for that to be reinvested in public services and to create an additional public health benefit, whereas we're introducing MUP. If we were to make the decision to introduce a public health levy, that would ensure that what is currently just excess profit going straight into the retailer's pocket is actually reinvested in the services used to support those who are suffering the consequences of alcohol and tobacco.
So there is no mechanism, as you pointed out, to harness any profits relating to minimum unit pricing. I think one of the challenges is really being able to separate out what is in relation to minimum unit pricing. That is a challenge. The sector will tell you that, and that's a reasonable point. So I think, you know, what I would want to convey today is that there are very strong arguments on both sides here, and what we want to do is to listen to all of that and make a considered judgment well in advance of 25-26 around what is the right balance here, to make sure that we are fair to the sector, which has, you know, no doubt had its challenges, but also that we recognise some of the public health challenges that you've just alluded to, which continue to put pressure on our health service and our economy as well.
Excuse me. Thank you for that. Switching back to another area, I was quite concerned about what you said in your opening statement around the cut to financial transactions that's in the supplementary estimates. Have you had any engagement from the UK government, bearing in mind that's on top of what was already a very bleak picture on FTs? Has there been any engagement from the UK government on why this is their current direction of travel on FTs?
So the position, I think, for us is it's very difficult in terms of how our budget is constructed and the process for our budget throughout the year. And I think it just highlights and demonstrates that our fortunes or otherwise are wholly dependent on decisions being made elsewhere. And it doesn't make for a sensible set of arrangements for being able to set a budget and then so take the in-year reductions that we had to make, which were very painful and very difficult. The Welsh have made this point as well, that if we knew how we were going to end up at the end of the financial year and had an indication of any in-year adjustments that were going to be made, then perhaps some of those decisions would not have to be made. Likewise, if we knew that financial transactions were going to be reduced, we would have been able, perhaps in year, to have made some account of that. But what we are now left with is having to look for flexibility from the Treasury to manage that reduction in FTs next year. At the very time the FTs and capital has been cut, we now have this surprise added into the mix that has come along at the last minute. And I guess I just make the point that it just highlights that the structure and the system is fundamentally a problem here. And that is what needs to be resolved, rather than us trying to manage these changes so late on in the year.
In a somewhat similar area, there's been reports over the last couple of days, I think there's a question selected for this afternoon on this, there might be an FMQ later in the week, around the decision to freeze additional capital spend in the health portfolio for the remainder of this financial year. Is that going to have any knock-on impact to capital allocations for next year's, but for the current draft budget going through? And if you could just give a little bit more context as to why that decision's been made for the remaining few months of this year.
So until we know what the position is at spring budget in relation to any changes to capital one way or the other, we really can't start projects that we might not have the money to finish. So that £1.6 billion that at the moment we will not have between now and 27-28, would have paid for a lot of health centres, to be frank. It's the cost of a major new hospital, for context. So we talk, you know, about percentages, but actually in cash terms, £540 million a year is a lot to lose every year in the run-up to 27-28. So our major call and the number one priority to Treasury has been a reversal of that capital position at the spring budget. And we need to see all of that before we can really make a judgment about the infrastructure investment plan going forward. It would not be a good use of funds to start projects that we can't finish. Now, I am hoping, and I'm eternally the optimist, that come the spring budget, that the other side of that, that we, I would want to be in a position to revisit that and to set out an infrastructure investment plan that is able to take some of those projects forward. At the moment, I just can't give that assurance because I don't know.
Thanks. One final question, if there's time, convener. Thanks. Going back again to something that's been touched on already, I think it was by the convener, the decisions around funding for the enterprise agencies. I understand completely that ultimately the budget needs to balance, and that makes it challenging to make the most strategic decisions in each individual portfolio area. But in this one, I'm particularly interested because I've been frustrated for a long time, for example, that money is given to the enterprise, or the enterprise agencies, Scottish Enterprise in particular, spends money on the film and TV sector. But Scottish Enterprise is not where the public sector expertise for supporting that sector sits. They sit within Screen Scotland, within Creative Scotland. In this year's budget, Create Scotland have got an uplift, so Screen Scotland is part of that, will benefit from that. Scottish Enterprise funding has gone down. You could make an argument that there's some level of strategic reallocation there. We will get better value for money from the same amount of money being deployed by Screen Scotland, where the expertise is, rather than by Scottish Enterprise. I don't get the impression that that was a strategic decision as such there. This was more just about, somebody needs to take the sharp end of this for the budget to balance overall. Was there any discussion, though, about where this money, that kind of money, to take that as an example, there's loads of other examples of public bodies with overlapping responsibility for various sectors. Mm-hmm. Are those kind of cross-portfolio discussions taking place to identify where we would actually get best value for money out of the money that's being transferred from the public sector to third and private?
More so now, but I think there's still room for improvement. So I think there has been a kind of thorough deep dive into each portfolio, each public sector body, what they do, what they should do, where there's overlap, where there's duplication. And without a doubt, there's still scope, I think, to do more in that territory, and questioning around, well, who is best placed, which public body is best placed to take forward a particular area of policy. You've made, made the point about Creative Scotland. I would concede the point that we probably could do more as part of the public service reform agenda. I'm really keen to explore not just who does what, but whether or not there could be more extracted from organisations working more closely together. At the end of the day, it's all public money, and we need to make sure that there are that organisations, including government departments, are coming out of their silos to work more effectively together. I think there's more that we can do in that space.
Thank you. That's convener.
Thank you very much. Michelle, to before by John.
Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Thank you for joining us. I've got a couple of quick wee points before I moved on to my more substantive questions. One, picking up on the points brought out around CapEx, given the really significant cuts, 20% anticipated in real terms by up to 2028-2029, would you consider also scheduling a debate? I mean, I think for the first time, ironically, the issue was becoming alive to people outside over the issues around the treatment centres and the implications of what actually this CapEx cut means. So I wonder if we would consider that. I mean, it's something, as you know, that's of great interest to me, and I have probably consistently asked about it. I just wonder whether the Cabinet Secretary would consider that. I think that would be valuable.
I'm certainly happy to consider it. I guess the question comes back to timing again. Do we do it before we know what the full picture is going to be like from the 6th of March and spring budget, or do we wait until we've got that full picture? I think that's a judgment, but I'm certainly open to to thinking about that. I think it's important that we have, you know, an honest debate around it, because, you know, when you know, there will no doubt be questions in Parliament about what's the implication for this project and or that project, understandably so. But the truth of it is, you know, you cannot remove, you know, £1.6 billion out of capital investment for that not to have an impact. So if that's not reversed, there will be an impact. And the question is just, where does it fall?
Exactly. And I think having that kind of discussion and fleshing out all the political parties and that could potentially be helpful. Mm. But carrying on just now, and it's off the back of some of the comments from the convener around the Scottish Fiscal Sustainability report in terms of single-year versus multi-year funding. I wonder if the Scottish Government collects any statistics as to the sunk costs of doing all this monitoring and assessment on a year-by-year basis, because it strikes me it's inefficient, but it's also extremely expensive. And I just wondered whether you collect any stats, because it's in effect money lost.
I'll ask maybe Alison to come in. I think it's a fair point. I guess I can't quite see what the solution would be unless we can move genuinely to multi-year funding that we know we can have some assurance that we're going to receive. Mm-hmm. And without that, it makes it very, very difficult to be able to work in a different way. But I mean, your point is a reasonable one, to be honest. Mm. Alison, I don't know.
Yeah, thank you. We don't have, it's not something that we're able to quantify at present, but certainly it's something we can look at as in a qualitative way as to the extra effort and the way that it takes us away from taking that more medium-term approach, as you say.
It strikes me both in a quantitative as well as a qualitative way it would be helpful, because it exemplifies the inefficiency which plays into some of our other...
We'll certainly take that away and consider okay. your point.
The other thing, which is something that I've asked about before, is around the ScotWind funding. Yeah. To be honest, I was a wee bit disappointed when I read the response from the Scottish Government to the committee, and it said, and I quote, consideration will be given to how future revenues will be deployed. Mm-hmm. And that was exactly the point I was trying to make. I don't want consideration to be given to how future revenues will be deployed. What I wanted to see was a recognition of the importance of, one, setting up a sovereign wealth fund, two, potentially some consideration to cost implications process, three, specifically some fiscal rules and a commitment to setting some fiscal rules. And to me, saying that as a commitment going forward, even though you can't bind your successors, I accept that, for this term, we will set aside 5%, for example, of all monies, because that recognises the revenue challenges you have today, but also looks longer term and starts to get the building blocks around fiscal sustainability. So I wonder if you'd like to comment on that reply, because it strikes me that it kind of misses the point altogether.
I take your point. I think... it's not an unreasonable request, and I think something we could give further consideration to. I think it would have to be very modest given the fiscal position, and I can envisage a scenario where, you know, we're again back in Parliament being asked questions about resources in the here and now, and we've got this pot sitting, however modest it is, it would be a focal point, I suspect, of, you know, why are you, you know, not deploying that for X, Y and Z. And those are the very real debates we have all the time around the here and now. If we were in a different fiscal position right here and now, that would absolutely be, for me, a very wise thing to do, and a very constructive way of you know, building that that resilience and it is one of the few genuinely flexible areas of funding that we have that are not constrained by all of the other machinations of the fiscal framework and so on and so forth. I guess you could make the point that I had at the Net Zero Committee, we had a discussion about this, about whether or not you could align the resources that are already being deployed with the $4.7 billion, for example, that are having a positive impact on our climate change goals. And I think you could. You could say, well, actually, you could cut that money however you wanted to in terms of investment into offshore wind, for example, and the commitments there, or in some of our other positive action on climate change. Something I will continue to give consideration to, and if we find ourselves in the kind of short to medium term in a better financial position, it's something that I think has some merit. I just feel quite constrained at the moment in being able to, when public services are absolutely requiring every pound of investment, I found myself quite torn between the attractiveness of doing what you're suggesting and having that money available in here and now.
I think the evidence tells us that the constrained environment for public services will continue. Mm-hmm. I mean, if one had to put a wee bet on it, that's what would suggest. So to me, that suggests that there's a higher need to do something like this because it's about fiscal sustainability. Mm-hmm. Just moving on, in terms of the... I'll just find the page, sorry, bear with me. It's about the social security spend, which mm-hmm. is another area where we know there have been concerns around long-term affordability and sustainability. Mm-hmm. Again, when I read through the response, ironically enough, having raised that point about the longer-term picture, the response said, deliberately referenced monitoring all areas of expenditure during the year. And that is exactly not the point, because the point is about, when you extrapolate the numbers, it's frankly not sustainable, particularly when it's demand-led, and therefore taking, regardless of whether it's a responsible and capable approach, only looking at it in year is exactly the point. So mm-hmm. I was surprised by that response. So do you recognise a very real concern, and it ties into comments earlier about the Fiscal Commission sustainability report and so on, and that it can't give confidence when we get answers asking about the long term, the answer says we'll take a responsible approach in year, because that's the issue. Arguably, we've been taking a responsible report in year, mm-hmm. every single year, but that's not the issue. The issue is the projection going forward that has concerned this committee so much.
Yeah, and I accept that we need to, and I alluded to that earlier on, that we are looking at the what can we do around that projection, how much of it lies in the... So the decisions around efficiency, effectiveness, decision-making, eligibility, all of these things are being looked at, I guess, for the system that we have at the moment, but it is still a system that is projected to continue to grow because we're still in the process of finalising the shift of benefits, and that journey is not complete. The point about demand-led is a fair one, but that gets us straight then into some quite difficult discussions mm-hmm. around, so what does the system look like in 5-10 years, and in order for it to be fair to everybody, does that mean that we need to review some of the elements of it? Those are not decisions that have been made, but I think it's something that inevitably Parliament and will have to debate these matters going forward. And also some of the decision-making around
the supports that are available at the moment, making sure that they are, you know, not completely out of kilter with perhaps systems that have been inherited, because that becomes unsustainable in terms of some of those decision making. What I would say about Social Security Scotland, that they are all over some of these issues and making sure that, as, for example, a new, if you take adult disability payment, for example, that there is that they're looking at things like consistency of decision making, and that there's no inconsistency arising where that would potentially lead to unfairness in the system. A position that becomes unsustainable going forward, with an exponential growth of awards, particularly awards at a higher level. So these are all things that are levers that can maybe be deployed in the shorter term. It doesn't necessarily address that longer term growth, and that's something that I think that Parliament will usefully perhaps have a view on, in terms of, well, where does Social Security sit within? It's now a big chunk. It's one of the key pillars of our budget, alongside health and local government. Where does that sit going forward? If it's going to continue to be so, and I suspect it will, then that will mean decisions elsewhere. And I think, just finally, for completion, there is something about us being able to reduce demand on Social Security by some of the other levers, clearly avoiding people kind of falling out of work into Social Security, then becoming dependent on things like adult disability payment. What can we do to try and interrupt some of that happening further upstream? That's quite a challenge, but it's something that we do need to give more attention to.
My last question concerns affordable housing, which I know I brought up before, and I just kind of picked up on something in the wording in the light around the commentary made about CapEx, which I strongly agree with. It's a significant challenge, and FTs. Your response says we remain focused on delivering 110,000 affordable homes. Previous language has been we remain committed to delivering 110,000 affordable homes. Is that a kind of an indicator, given the very real challenges, significant challenges around CapEx and FTs that we've discussed earlier?
So there's a lot of moving parts around this at the moment. The Housing Minister has been very active in looking at trying to lever in additional investment through private sector investment into affordable housing, so mid-market rent in particular, and how we might be able to utilise some of our funding to create business models that make that more straightforward. So we are looking at how we can be imaginative. I want us, I'm less precious about how and where the funding comes from in order to keep on track. I guess the only point I would make is the CapEx, the capital reduction is challenging enough, but it comes hot on the heels of construction inflation being, peak of 25% at one point. That is never going to go back to what it was previously. So you've got a pot of money, there's less bangs for the bucks because of all those in higher cost basis. So that is a challenge even before the challenge of capital funding availability. So we're going to have to look very closely at what can be done and what is the trajectory of delivery of that. And if we can lever in those external sources of funding, then that will help us to make sure we can deliver and keep on track. But it will be a challenge.
OK, thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. John, to be followed by Michael.
Thanks, Convener. We've covered a bit of ground already, so I'll try not to be too repetitive. But the whole question of our relationship with the UK tax and national insurance system came up earlier with the convener. And I mean, it does seem to me that the fundamental problem here is that the UK has two income tax systems, namely income tax and national insurance. and they do not relate to each other at all well. Have you picked up any suggestion that the UK government is even looking at this, thinking of combining them, anything like that?
No.
No.
No, and I mean, I picked up probably what you've picked up, that, you know, we're in kind of you know, movable feasts here, where, you know, there's speculation about further tax cuts. We're in an election year. Clearly, that is going to be a factor. And, you know, we've got this major fiscal event on the 6th of March, which, you know, if you listen to press briefings alluding to further tax cuts, others saying that that's not sustainable. And if you look at OBR commentary saying it definitely is not sustainable, there's nothing that I've seen that suggests any kind of long-term strategy for looking at any of these issues. It seems very short-term at the moment.
OK, thanks. Well, that's kind of what I feared, because I just think it doesn't matter what we do, as long as you've got PYE or income tax and national insurance as they are in the UK, we've got a real problem. On another kind of tax, obviously, council tax, and you've commented on council tax reform and made the point, which we know, that there's not agreement, no consensus at the moment on what should replace council tax. I just think some of us are getting a little bit frustrated that, you know, we need to do something, and it's clearly nothing we do is going to have 100% support. But, you know, is the government committed to making some kind of change fairly soon?
So, yes, absolutely. And you could break it into two parts. One is some of the short-term reforms that were already taken forward in relation to things like second homes, empty homes, for example, I think are helpful. But the commitment is absolute around what does that longer-term reform look like, and can we land in a space that is a fundamental reform either to the council tax system itself or a new system. So that's local government committed to that. I think there's, I would hope, an element of cross-party consensus that, you know, there needs to be reforms to the system. Whether we can find that consensus space, I don't know. I think it would be very helpful, because whatever we land on has to stand the test of time going forward. It has to be fair. It has to address some of the anomalies. It has to, you know, be able to raise enough revenue. So all of these key elements. We've got the joint working group that is actually functioning very well, that has been focused mainly on some of those short-term reforms. But without a doubt, you know, we absolutely need to set out a path to that longer-term reform. It's not going to happen overnight. It clearly will take a bit of time, but a destination point has to be agreed, and we're keen for that to happen.
Because, I mean, even if it was just a reform of the present system and a revaluation, I mean, that in itself would be a major thing, given that the last revaluation was, what, 23 years ago. And it does seem to me there's a kind of fairness and equality issue in this, because, again, if looking at Glasgow, it does seem that property values have gone up more in some areas than other areas, and I would suggest they've not gone up so much in poorer areas, like my constituency. Yeah. And therefore, they are relatively losing out every year that goes past.
Yeah, I mean, all these elements would need to be taken account of in terms of any proposition for any alternative system. And I think any system of local taxation will have to have a property element. I think for me is important. And trying to reach agreement on a system that perhaps addresses some of these issues, it's going to be tricky, and there are lots of political challenges within all of that. But I do think that I'm keen, if there is the space within Parliament, for example, to try and create a bit of consensus around these matters, then I think that would be really helpful. the fiscal framework where local government is important to COSLA and to local government. They want to see a reformed system that gives, that addresses some of the anomalies that we're all well aware of. So I think that's a challenge. I'm keen, as I say, to try and create a bit of consensus in that space if possible.
OK, thanks very much. In relation to the infrastructure investment plan, you say that the next IIP will be published in due course. Mm-hmm. Is that May or is that some other time?
It'll be after the spring budget, yes. Once we've had a chance to look at what that picture looks like and to make judgments about what does that mean for the capital availability. I just would caveat, and I guess it comes with a health warning, that it could be a better position than we have at the moment, but it could also be a worse position than we have at the moment. And that would impact very directly on the assumptions that are already made in the budget. I hope that is not the case. But I think it would be wise, and that's why I came back the way I did to the committee's report, because I just, you know, if we were to do it now, pre 6th of March, we would literally be revisiting it straight away because of what the 6th of March is going to potentially bring us.
Yeah, OK. Just following on Michelle Thompson's point about the ScotWind money, I mean, I was just wondering, I accept the point that it's very hard to start a savings scheme or investment fund or whatever, sovereign wealth fund, when we're in real financial challenges. Would a compromise be that that money could be ring-fenced for capital expenditure? So be it, not necessarily just renewables, but I mean housing, roads, railways, whatever, that we could say that money, because that's an investment for the future, mm-hmm. although we're not setting the money aside, we'd be saying this money is definitely going to an investment?
I mean, at the moment, it is supporting the spending side of the budget, and without which, you know, a difficult budget would have been made even worse. I take your point, and you know, I'm not unsympathetic to the suggestions being made, and I certainly don't have a closed mind to it at all, either your point or Michelle Thompson's point. I guess I'm just wrestling with the here and now and trying to wrestle with the here and now and have an eye to the future. It's a bit of a tension when I'm literally looking at, you know, pounds, shilling and pence in portfolio allocations and the difficult discussions and decisions that are having to be made around that. It is a challenge. But as I say, I don't have a closed mind to the principle of it at all.
OK, and the final issue was just really, I mean, we note that the UK is going into recession, and whether it's technical or not, it is a recession. Mm. And we're sometimes told that by raising tax, that somehow damages growth. But we're looking at the UK, which is in a recession, so it's not growing, under a Conservative government. And the UK has relatively low tax compared to other countries, 38% of GDP in tax compared to France at 50. So how do you reflect on the fact that the UK is a low tax economy and is not growing?
Well, it's that it was a Resolution Foundation described as stagnation nation with all of the above that you've just described. And actually, Scotland's position within that very difficult economic and fiscal climate is, you know, a number of key indicators that show that, for example, Scotland's GDP per capita has grown faster than the UK's since 2007. We have productivity grown at an annual average rate of 1% a year in Scotland compared to UK's 0.5%. We're making better progress on things like the gender pay gap. And, of course, we've got, you know, in terms of inward investment, the top-performing region outside London, the South East, third-highest wages and GVA per person in the last measurement of 2021. So, you know, sometimes there is a narrative about the Scottish economy that is put forward by those who, you know, seek to portray a particular narrative. But actually, I'm not downplaying any of the challenges, but the key economic indicators shows that there are many strengths underlying the Scottish economy that perhaps that show a trend and a change over a number of years. The tax base, for one, is up, and that is good. And you know, that, as I say, I'm not downplaying any of the challenges. But was it Fraser of Allender has adopted an atmosphere of cautious optimism for 2024, which is, you know, Fraser of Allender can be quite challenging at times. So, you know, I think that's something that is welcome.
OK, thanks, Convener.
OK, thank you. Michael, to be followed by Jamie.
Thanks, Convener. You gave some answers earlier on, Deputy First Minister, on the council tax and the money being baselined into the budget for next year. So senior councillors across Scotland are telling me that their finance officers are telling them not to believe you. Is that a problem, that trust has collapsed so much that people setting their budgets are having to make those assumptions?
Oh, I don't know who you've been speaking to, obviously. I mean, I speak with local government regularly, local government leaders regularly of all parties. I've given those assurances to be helpful, and not least at COSLA were asking me about the baselining. I thought it was important to give certainty about that, and that's the certainty that I've given, alongside obviously the £45 million being contingent on the spring budget, showing that that is a positive addition rather than us being in a negative position. The relationship with local government, it's been challenging through this budget process. I think probably every budget I can recall, it's a time of tension with local government. I think this year is no different from that. I think, though, one of the asks, I do recall COSLA saying was one of their top asks, was about the share of the budget. I would just reflect that the share of local government has is an increasing share from 31 to 32% of the overall budget. I think that shows that despite the really challenging fiscal environment, that local government has got an increasing share of what is a constrained cake, if you like. They've got a bigger slice of it. Is something that needs to be borne in mind. I will continue to discuss with local government. We've got a lot that we are working very positively on. We don't always hear about that in the public domain, but there is a lot of joint work going on in a lot of areas that will be good for public services.
You recognise how difficult this budget settlement is for local government at the moment.
And difficult for the whole public sector.
And Councillor Hageman came to Parliament on the 16th of January and said there were surprises in the budget. One of the lines that we were working on was that there would be no surprises, but that has not been the case. So you're talking about the basis on which they had made demands, but actually you had an agreement with them. Are we not heading... This was meant to be a different year, the Verity House Agreement. It's really just been ditched, isn't it?
No, the Verity House Agreement is really important to COSLA. I met with the presidential team just a couple of weeks ago, and they were stressing, despite the difficulties of the budget and some of the disagreements, how important the Verity House Agreement was to them, because apart from anything else, it will deliver a new fiscal framework that will be helpful going forward. It has delivered a whole range of issues and areas of progress that, again, are perhaps not the ones that we hear about, because inevitably the areas that get the attention in the public domain are those areas where there's disagreement rather than the areas that there's agreement on. And there's a lot of areas where we're taking forward major areas of policy that
Can I give you Stephen Heddle, Councillor Stephen Heddle, who said that despite the Verity House Agreement rhetoric about working together on shared priorities, it's the same outcome at budget time for local government in reality. Well, he doesn't really agree with you in terms of there's a big, huge range of other areas. This is the core issue right now, and they don't feel that they're being treated fairly and being given the truth by ministers.
So Stephen Heddle was at that meeting, and he was one of the... the commentators at the meeting saying that despite some of the difficulties, and don't get me wrong, these meetings can be robust, of course they are, but he was pointing out that despite all of that, there are areas of importance that they want to work with us on, and the Verity House Agreement is really, really important for them. You know, I can go back to many budgets around local government, and they do take a bit of a pattern of local government will ask for you know, X amount of money, and there will be, you know, some difficult discussions, and then we land on where we land. This year is difficult, and you know, you could say, you know, you could say that for the whole of the public sector,
but the
difference, there's less money.
Yeah, but the difference this year was to be that there were to be no threats. There was to be no take this or I'm going to punish you for it. But that's exactly what you're doing now.
So I'll come back to the council tax in a second, but I make the point that in a budget where there is less money, that the size of the cake is reduced, local government literally has a bigger slice of it. So 31 to 32%. That tells me that, you know, that within a difficult financial environment and settlement, that local government have been treated reasonably fairly. If you're talking about the council tax freeze in particular, then, or teacher numbers, then I guess there is a judgment to make. So local government will say, you know, the £145 million for teachers should not be ring-fenced, and they should be able to spend that on whatever they want. I suspect that your colleagues in the education portfolio would be the first in Parliament to be asking why the Scottish Government had allowed teacher numbers to reduce and why we were removing ring fencing from teachers. Now, I actually think teachers are a really important part of reducing and eliminating the poverty-related attainment gap. They're not the whole story, as the convener was pointing out earlier on, but they are an important part of the story. So either if we put £145 million into having more teachers, we expect local government to then make sure that the teacher workforce is of a size that can help deliver that poverty-related attainment gap closing. The same with the council tax freeze. We've put £147 million into helping local government deliver a council tax freeze. That money is for the freeze. And, you know, I don't think it would be acceptable to council taxpayers for us to say, well, you know, you can have the money and you can put council tax up as well. I don't think that's going to wash with council taxpayers. So the money is on the table, and it is for councils to decide. We have already seen a number of councils of all political colours make the decision to freeze the council tax. I know it's obviously a policy of UK Labour as well for council tax freeze to be supported. So, you know, in difficult financial times, you know, we have, I think, been fair to local government. But, you know, it is a tough budget, and it is tough for the whole of the public sector.
I'll move on. Can I ask, do you now know what the budget for further education is?
So the budget for further education is, as I laid out previously.
You didn't lay it out previously, but...
Well, I gave the global amount that was for higher and further education. If you're asking me whether the Funding Council have agreed with universities and colleges around the places, if that's what you're asking me, then those discussions are ongoing, as I understand. And I think last year,
so
it was
no.
the spring so, time before those discussions had completed. And, you know, I think this year will be no different. Springtime will be when those discussions are concluded, and colleges and universities will have the final agreement with the Scottish Funding.
I think this is the fourth time I've asked you this.
There's nothing different this year than any other year.
Well, there's something. Sorry, there's nothing.
There's nothing different this year.
Well, that's not what the college sector tell
me. Well, it was spring of last year when the final agreement with the Scottish Funding Council was reached. So there's not any different this year at all. In terms of those discussions with the Scottish Funding Council. Okay. Spring last year, it'll be spring this year.
Okay. Okay. The Flexible Workforce Development Fund, obviously of huge concern to the colleges and also to employers. There's been, since the last time you're here, an awful lot of coverage from that about people asking, can you maybe just give us your justification as to why you think that was an area that should be cut in preference to other areas?
Well, portfolios have had to wrestle with some very difficult decisions because there's less money to go around. And in fact, with tax cuts that you're proposing to be even less, I think over £500 million less to spend on public services. So even with the tax position that we have proposed and that has raised, you know, £389 million of additional funding, difficult decisions have had to be made, and each portfolio had to make the judgments of where those areas that couldn't be sustained have had to have funding reduced. And the Flexible Workforce Development Fund has been one of those areas. Despite that, we recognise that Scotland's colleges are absolutely the heart of the skills system. And will be a major part going forward. Obviously, we have the review of the skills landscape, and colleges within that are going to continue to play a very, very important role going forward.
Yeah, because the Federation of Small Businesses have also made representation on this particular area, and you've said, despite the evidence that we've had, that this is a budget for growth. This seems to be one of the key asks for quite a reasonably small amount of money in the global budget. There seems to be a really key issue that cuts across a variety of different stakeholders within that economic side to it. I just feel that it could do with a little bit more of a robust justification.
Well, there are hundreds of small pots of money across the whole of government that all add up to a lot of money. And I guess I took the strategic decision that I was going to prioritise frontline spend. So frontline spend in our frontline public services required me to shift money in that direction, which means it's difficult for other areas of spend. Would we wish it was otherwise? Of course. But with less money, there is less money to go round, and every budget, therefore, has to be looked at, and the strategic priority was frontline spend on our public services, which is why, you know, again, at an evidence session, we've not heard quite so much about, you know, frontline spend on the NHS or police or fire. And I suspect the reason for that is because those are the areas where we've prioritised the spend going to. And what we do hear about are the areas that have had to take a hit in order to do that. And you've highlighted one. And, you know, if you want to come to me when we have our meeting and suggest that that is the priority that you would like to see addressed, and you can suggest to me where we would look to make changes elsewhere, then of course I'm happy to hear that.
Okay. Can I ask about higher education? Since you published the budget, we have had the admission figures for international postgraduate students across Scotland. There's been a very significant decline in big parts of that market. Can you tell us what impact you think that is going to have on the budgets of our higher education institutions?
Well, our higher education institutions will, you know, as ever, have a challenging set of circumstances that they will need to wrestle with. So one of the circumstances that you'll be well aware of is the restriction on international students, for example. So I'm not downplaying these factors that are all at play with universities, and they will have to manage the levers that they have in order to find a path through. I think the larger universities have the ability probably to do that more readily. I think there are perhaps some particular challenges for some of our smaller institutions compared to the larger institutions. But, you know, I don't downplay the pressures that are here on our university sector. The point I would make is that, you know, we have supported as best we can within the available resources for the university-funded places. And, you know, we've given the best support we can
given the limitations of the budget.
I suppose what I'm saying is that since you made the budget announcement, you've not brought any amendments today. You know, the circumstances in the universities has changed quite significantly. We now see, and it's the medium-sized institutions, I think, that are particularly affected in Scotland, some perhaps running in-year deficits of up to £15 million, with very significant issues in terms of what that might result in terms of their own budgets. So have you had those discussions with the sector in terms of how you could flex or assist in any way?
So discussions with the sector will continue, and of course, you know, we want to try and be as helpful as we can. But you know, you would literally be asking me to bring forward amendments to take money from elsewhere to give to the universities. If you're suggesting where that comes from, then you know, I'm all ears. But you know,
to be fair, Cabinet Secretary, that's not what I'm suggesting. What I'm suggesting is that the circumstances have materially changed that will affect employment in Scotland for people in these institutions, their financial stability, and whether you've had the conversations with them about actually how robust that is. I think that's a pretty reasonable question to ask.
Conversations it is, and conversations, as I just said, take place with the sector on an ongoing basis. I've had individual discussions with some institutions as well, and of course these issues have been brought to the fore. Until the 6th of March, though, I don't know whether the money we even have in this budget is going to be there, let alone have any additional funding. So there is a scenario where, you know, the UK government makes decisions at on the 6th of March that could actually impact negatively on the funding that we have available. I hope that's not the case, but of course we'll continue to discuss with higher education and others how we can work with them. If there's things we can do that are helpful beyond trying to find money that doesn't exist, then of course there are maybe other areas that can be looked at that could be helpful to them.
And last time you were here, I asked around the £28.5 million cut to the university's teaching budgets. I postulated that on dividing that by the amount of money that's allocated per head student, that would result in 3,900 student placement cuts for Scottish students. You said you didn't recognise that figure at that point, but really the question here is about whether you're going to instruct the Scottish Funding Council, as ministers do, to take the cut the number of places or to cut the amount per student. Are we any further forward in making that instruction to the Scottish Funding Council?
So the Scottish Funding Council are, as I said earlier on, they're in the process, as they were last year, and produced this in the spring, of producing the academic year 24-25 indicative allocations for both colleges and universities, which will provide the detail you're looking at in terms of university-funded places. That will be expected in the spring of this year, as it was in the spring of last year. We spent a lot of time at the last session talking about the 1,200 places for universities, which of course Universities Scotland have been very clear were COVID additional places, which were never envisaged to be there for the long term. So they always knew that those places would be reduced, and the time frame was always very clear. So we'll allow, you know, the Scottish Funding Council to get on with the job that they do every year.
I'm not sure that's really how it works, though. Cabinet Secretary, what happens is that ministers would indicate what the cap is in terms of the number of students that would be admitted. It's a ministerial decision that they speak to the SFC about, and then a letter is sent. So that's the issue in terms of the number of students. And what they're waiting, as far as I'm aware, for is an instruction from ministers as to whether it is less money per student or fewer students. And do we know if that ministers have given that instruction to the Scottish Funding Council? This isn't about negotiation with universities. It's about ministers and the Scottish Funding Council who work for the ministers.
Well, the Scottish Funding Council will be discussing with colleges and universities what the number of places are. And of course, that will be within the overall budget that's been allocated to colleges and universities. But you're literally asking me here about, you know, additional money
I'm genuinely not. What I'm asking you is about whether you're telling the universities to cut the number of students or cut the amount of money per student. That's not about additional money. I'm asking you about the process that you're undertaking with the university.
Well, the Scottish,
via
funding,
the Scottish
Council,
funding Council,
as I've said, will be discussing with both sets of institutions around the number of places and the overall budget that's been set as the overall environment the Scottish Funding Council will be operating in. And that is the budget that has already been set out. So the figure is there, and that is the context of what the Scottish Funding Council will be operating within in terms of those institutions. And as I say, the spring of last year, the spring of this year, will be when those places will be agreed with both sets of institutions. But, you know, if you're, it's a very challenging financial environment. It would be made more challenging, of course, if the tax decisions that we've made had not been made, something that I think you have alluded to. You're against the tax rises. You have said that you would want to cut the intermediate rate of tax, all of which I think would lead us to having £500 million of less money, whether it's for universities, colleges, health, local government. So you can't just talk about the tax side of things. You have to also address the spend side of the budget in terms of the decisions that you're saying you would take.
I'm also just asking about the competent operation of the system, Cabinet Secretary. Uh-huh. And the question here is, we've got people applying for university courses being given conditional or unconditional place at the moment. But the difference at the moment is that there's going to be this significant cut to the teaching budget, and the universities who are offering conditional and unconditional places don't know how many places they can offer.
And as I've said to you...
And this is not usual.
Well, it is. There's nothing different about this year that happened last year. The position is the same, and the budget process is exactly the same this year as it was last year. The negotiations with the Scottish Funding Council are no different this year than they were last year. But if you're saying to me... You want more money for universities and colleges.
That's not what I'm saying, Cabinet Secretary.
You have to decide whether you're saying you want more money or not.
That's the view
you can't
here. I'm
just
keen to move
describe
on.
A problem.
Keen to move on. Back to the report, Jamie.
Thank you very much, convener. I just wanted to go back to the issues around the enterprise bodies and relating to economic growth. When you came before this committee in January, I asked you about the cuts to the budgets for Highlands and Islands Enterprise and for South of Scotland Enterprise, and you suggested that they would be focusing their attention on kind of key priorities. You also said they, in your response, you talked about key things that matter, key priorities for delivery, key interventions, key sectors for growth. Today, earlier, I think with the convener, you talked about prioritised funding and an approach which is careful and targeted. But we still don't know the detail of where you think those priorities and those key focuses are going to be. The budgets have been cut, so what are you looking for them to deliver, and what are they now not going to be able to deliver, given their role, as you state in your report, their important role in driving economic growth?
Well, the detail of what we ask our enterprise agencies to do will be part of the discussion and then the correspondence and agreement of the priorities with the Wellbeing Economy Secretary. I guess the point I was making is that as ministers we have a responsibility to not ask organisations to do more with less, and I think that's a principle that is a fair one. So in order for them to focus on what is key, we would expect them to be looking at, for example, the key objectives of NSET, supporting growth of local businesses within their area, all of the key priorities. There are some things that may take longer for them to do and may have to be done over a longer time frame, and there are things they may have to pause or stop doing, the detail of which, though, will be for local partners to discuss and for the Economy Secretary to be involved in setting the strategic direction of travel, rather than for me to say, as the Finance Secretary, what they shouldn't do. I'm just making the point that we recognise that with constrained resources, we can't ask them to be doing more with less.
So given what you said today and what you said previously, you're accepting that our you know, key enterprise bodies, Highlands Islands Enterprise, South Scotland Enterprise, are going to be less able to drive economic growth to support those businesses need to than they have been in previous years?
What I'm saying is they will have to focus what they are doing on those key priorities or maybe other things so that they are doing or have been doing that they may have to do less of in order for them to focus the resources on that key objective. But you know, the brutal truth is the strategic priority we have taken is to invest as much as we can of the limited resources we have in public services and frontline public services. That means difficult decisions elsewhere. If you've got less resources, you can't give everybody the same amount of money. You have to prioritise. I've been very clear, I think, throughout this session, I've prioritised public services. That's meant difficult decisions, whether it's the enterprise agencies or universities, because otherwise I would have to be cutting frontline public services. Those are choices, and we've had to make those difficult choices. So within that resource that they do have, we need to be really clear on the priorities that we would expect them to deliver. And there may be things that would be things we would have liked them to do, but they may have to take longer or they may have to be paused or stopped.
Okay. Taking that on board, and I mean, you talk about priorities in areas, you know, where we're cutting. So we've kind of accepted that they are going to be less effective, less efficient at driving economic growth. As our report highlights, how are you going to monitor monitor the impact of those cuts on their ability to deliver economic growth?
Well, we would expect that to be done through the normal monitoring arrangements of our enterprise agencies, and we would expect them to be prioritising economic growth and support to businesses, new starts, growth. There are other areas of the work that enterprise agencies do that they may need to reduce. So within those discussions of what is done and the monitoring of that with the normal civil service processes of oversight and then ministerial oversight, we would expect those enterprise agencies to be clear about their objectives, what they're setting out, and then to be measured against those. I guess the point I was trying to make is that, as you know, sometimes that I was referring earlier on to business leaders that I met who referred to the six-page letter that an enterprise agency had received from ministers at the time, and they were pointing out that it should be literally one or two pages, and it should be key elements rather than a whole list of things. I think that's actually a fair point, and when resources are tight, you really need to focus on doing perhaps fewer things, but doing them well and to the best of their ability. And of course, economic growth and support to local businesses is their key objective. All I'm saying is there may be other things that may have to take less priority.
I mean, I would hope that they're doing things to the best of their ability anyway.
Well, I'm talking about the number of things that they are doing.
So when you're setting the budget, if you're setting the budget again next year, you will have reduced expectations for what they're going to be able to deliver, because this isn't the first cut. This is a number of years of cuts that the enterprise bodies have faced. Well, so how will you, how will we not get into essentially a spiral where enterprise bodies are set targets on reduced budgets, they deliver less, albeit you might argue deliver it better, but they deliver less. How are we not going to be in a position where their budgets continue to be cut because they're not, because you're expecting them to deliver less?
So the easy answer to that, and the straightforward one, is that we don't see a real terms cut to the Scottish budget that we saw at the autumn statement. So if we see, for example, a better fiscal position emerge from the spring budget, and that if we're allowed by the Treasury to use that as our basis of our forecast rather than the autumn statement, and if at the next autumn statement we see an enhanced position of our fiscal position, then we can address all of these points. But with less money, we cannot give every part of the public sector and all of our agencies the same amount of money, because it just doesn't exist. So, you know, you can take a salami slice and you can say, well, there needs to be less money for health or for police and for fire. But I suspect if I had done that, the questions today would have been centred on those public services. So you know, we that the easy answer is the more money we have available to us and the bigger the cake, then we can address the issue of the enterprise agencies, our higher education, further education institutions. But when there's less money, we have to make these really difficult decisions.
I mean, that point might have more standing if there hadn't been cuts when times had been better as well. I asked at the, again, when you were here in January about, it's really just for clarification around Business Gateway now. Mm. Apologies if I've missed it in the quite large amount of papers that we've received for this meeting, but okay. Can you advise if there is government support going into Business Gateway? And if so, how it's going and why it isn't identified in the budget at all?
Do we have that level of detail? I'm afraid I don't have that level of detail with me, but I will absolutely come back at the earliest opportunity.
Okay.
Yep.
All right, thanks very much. I mean, we all accept, just before I'm going to, we all accept that economic growth is absolutely important, absolutely vital, you know, for jobs, for our economy, but also, obviously, for taxes. How do you respond to the comments of Sandy Begbie from Scottish Financial Enterprise at the weekend, who said that the Scottish Government's tax policy is making Scotland a dangerous place in which to create wealth?
Well, I have got a lot of respect for Sandy Begbie, and of course we should listen to all voices in this matter. We have tried to, through our tax decisions, not just this budget, but for a number of years, to develop a tax system that is progressive, that is based on those with the broadest shoulders pay a bit more, and the result of that is we have £1.5 billion of additional revenues that we wouldn't have had we followed the UK government's tax position. Now, if we didn't have that £1.5 billion, we would have even less for the enterprise agencies, less for universities and colleges. So our tax decisions have led to a significant level of additional revenues for the Scottish budget. So these are choices that have to be made. But on the one hand, you can't ask for more money. It is not a proposition that I think has much merit of lower taxes and higher spend. I don't understand how that would work. I think if you have lower taxes and taxes are reduced, then you have less money to spend. That's those are the choices also facing the Chancellor at the spring budget on the 6th of March. And I really hope that he prioritises investment in the public services rather than tax cuts, because that would enable us to make the investments in our enterprise agencies or our universities or colleges. But that is essentially the two sides of the budget. And these are the issues that we have to grapple with at each budget.
I mean, I get that. And without going on, getting into a discussion on the Laffer curve and areas around that, it must be worrying that a senior position, a person within a vitally important sector in terms of the Scottish economy, is saying that your tax policy is making Scotland a dangerous place to essentially base themselves.
As I said, I respect Sandy Begbie. I mean, I wouldn't agree with that description. Earlier on in the session, I gave a number of economic indicators that actually show, and I also quoted the Fraser of Allender Institute, who are not always don't always use the language that they've used in relation to the outlook for the Scottish economy. So despite the recession that we're seeing UK-wide, and despite those financial and economic challenges, the economic indicators show improved productivity, improved tax take and wage growth, and I think all of these indicators show that Scotland is still a very good place to invest and do business, whether that's inward investment or indeed business decisions in terms of their own investment decisions here in Scotland. So I think that all I can do is to point to the economic indicators, which perhaps just give a bit of a different narrative than some of the other things that we've heard. But as I say, I've a lot of respect rather for Sandy Begbie, but I don't agree with his description on that.
Okay. If I could just move on to an area around the rural affairs budget and agriculture funding, and I just remind members of my register of interest in terms of agriculture. It's not mentioned in your report, because it was mentioned in our report but not as a recommendation, but we saw cuts to the rural affairs budget and £33 million of ring-fence agriculture funding as part of the Bew review has not been allocated back to the budget. Do you know yet when it will be?
So let me say a couple of things. One is, I go back to the point that, you know, with less money, there is less money and less money to go around. And, you know, if these decisions have been very, very difficult. In terms of the funding, there is the ring fence funding of £61 million. That I have given a commitment that will be returned to the portfolio. The first instalment of £15 million is being returned in 24-25. And I will look at the remainder of the funds being returned in full at the right time in negotiation with the sector.
Do you have any time? So, apologies to interrupt. Well, do you have any timescales that you have to have that returned back?
So I want practical. No, but I want to do that in a way that supports the reform and transformation of Scotland's farming and food production industry. That's the purpose of that funding. That's what the sector wants it to be for. But I want to do that in a way that brings it in at the right time for the sector, because otherwise, if it's not the right time, there's a danger of it coming in a way that potentially isn't going to be spent. So the preparation has to be done so that, in terms of the reform and transformation, we're clear on what is needed when. So those discussions are ongoing. But what I can say is an absolute commitment that all of the £61 million will be returned, and it will be done in a way that is absolutely in line with what the sector needs.
I mean, if funding which you accept is ring-fence for agriculture can be taken out of agriculture, used in other areas, as make the case that budget constraints are tied, with a commitment but no commitment on timescales to return it back, or when it will be, or how it will be returned back, does it make a bit of a mockery of the idea of it being ring-fenced? Because
no,
surely it's just general funds.
No, because it will come back and it will be used for that purpose. So the ring fencing remains. It's just about the profiling of the funding. So there's no question about the funding. The funding will be returned. It's just about the profiling of that funding, because to be honest, there is a danger of the funding not being spent if the sector isn't prepared and ready to use it for the reform and transformation it wants to use it for. So it has to be returned in a way, the profiling of which meets the needs of the sector, so that they're ready to do X, the money comes in to help them do X in the right year when they're ready to do that. So there'll be an element of backloading, I suspect, because there's still a lot of work going on around the preparation of reform and transformation. But you know, that money is ring-fenced. It is for that purpose. It will be returned. We're talking to the sector about when. £15 million already committed for 24-25. The remainder will be returned thereafter. And the split of that and the profiling of it will be negotiated.
Can I just say, I mean, in terms then, on the general principles of ring-fencing, if the Scottish Government can take ring-fence money and use it across their budgets, why shouldn't local councils take ring-fence money from the Scottish Government and use it across their... what's the difference there, principally?
I will bring Alison in, but actually it's not about taking that money and spending it elsewhere in the budget. It's been that money has been constrained, so there's less money. So the profiling of that money is being deployed in a way that is required by the sector, that is able to be deployed in a way that is needed, but also is affordable. There's no point in us sitting with £61 million sitting in a budget line that isn't going to be spent, it's going to be underspent, when actually that means we've had to reduce funding elsewhere in order to provide that.
You've reduced funding from the rural affairs budget. So what you're arguing is that we can't find a use for this money within the rural affairs budget, but you've cut the rural affairs budget. And just on the point that I was really asking about, Why should a local authority that receives ring-fence funding from the Scottish Government for certain parts of their public service delivery, why shouldn't they look at it and say, well, if the Scottish Government can use ring-fence funding for what it wants to, why shouldn't we be able to do the same, given their budget pressures that they're under?
So on that point, we have removed ring-fencing coming year of almost £1 billion for local government. So nearly £1 billion of local government funding will have ring fencing removed. So they'll be able to. So there'll be flexibility on nearly £1 billion that was previously ring fenced. So I think that shows a direction of travel with local government. We want to do more. We've got an agreement, the Verity House Agreement, as part has that as a key element of an ongoing journey. The remainder areas of ring fencing are areas that are a bit more tricky. So we talked about one earlier on about teacher numbers and the need for us to move cautiously, because we don't want to see teacher numbers going off a cliff, because I think questions would then be asked about, well, what have you done, Education Secretary, to avoid teacher numbers going off a cliff when they're so fundamentally important to reducing the poverty-related attainment gap. So we are on a journey to remove ring fencing, and we have made good progress, but you know, there are some remaining areas that we'll have to move cautiously through as we work with local government to get to our joint aim, and that is to further remove ring fencing going forward.
Okay, if I've got time for very brief.
Very brief.
Very brief.
We're an hour over time already.
My apologies, Convener.
You've been too generous to members, that's the problem.
It's actually following up really what on something that Ross Greer talked about in terms of capital investment in some of the NHS, and we've seen obviously plans for New Belford delayed and other areas. Obviously, those delays to new buildings mean that the NHS boards are going to have to look at how they can, you know, get the most out of the facilities they've got. So, increased maintenance costs. Has that been, or will that be, covered or represented in their budgets going forward? Increased maintenance costs to basically increase the longevity of the facilities that they've got that would have been replaced with new buildings?
Well, so let me say a couple of things about that. We've said that while we await the spring budget, and of course the best way of addressing the point you're making about new NHS facilities is for the Chancellor to reverse the capital cut and not have 1.6 billion.
You have made that point. I know
no, but it's an important point
time,
I'm going to make again.
I just wonder
because,
if you talk about the NHS.
Because if there's
budget.
Less capital money, there's less money for NHS buildings, infrastructure or anything else. So that is the solution. Meantime, what we've said is two things. One is that the priority needs to be on maintenance, so essential maintenance, for the capital that the NHS does have available, and that we will look after the 6th of March at what the resources look like. The 6th of March capital position, both in terms of UK government and anything that we are able to do in terms of our own position, depending where we end up with the year end, to revisit that in the infrastructure investment plan. So it's not the end of the story, but we couldn't have projects starting that might not be able to be taken forward, because that would just use money in starting projects that couldn't then be completed, and that's not a good use of public money. So we've had to pause until we get that picture. In the meantime, we would expect essential maintenance to be taken forward as a key priority by boards.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you very much, and thanks to colleagues. As I said, I have been very generous with time today, and your time, of course, in particular, Deputy First Minister, because we've been asking questions for an hour longer than was originally proposed. So I want to thank you for answering so many questions in such detail, and of course, I think we were all probably guilty of wandering off the report at certain points. We know that stage three of the budget is next Tuesday. Given some of the questions that were asked and comments made, have any opposition parties come forward with alternative fully costed budget proposals?
None.
Okay, thank you. We now move to our second agenda item, which is to consider the budget bill at stage two. We have no amendments, but in terms of the standing orders, we are obliged to consider each section and schedule of the bill and the long title and agree to each formally. We will take the sections in order, with schedules being taken immediately after the section that introduces them and the long title last. Fortunately, standing orders allow us to put a single question where groups of sections All schedules are to be considered consecutively, and unless members disagree, that is what I propose to do. Firstly, the question is that Section 1, Schedule 1, Section 2, Schedule 2, Section 3, Schedule 3 and Sections 4 to 11 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. Secondly, the